We're on to the part of the program, we're going to hear some more music. So part of the story of a musical instrument becoming accepted is the genres of music that you can play with the instrument. If you get a new genre of music, it's more likely a new instrument will be accepted. I mentioned the example of the saxophone and jazz. In 1966, Robert Moog got very excited because a hit record came with the first use of an electronic instrument. And that record was by the Beach Boys, of all groups. I'm certain you've heard it, Good Vibrations. And this used the electronic sound of the theremin, that instrument which I described, which you play without touching. It's a very weird instrument, makes this wailing noise. And Good Vibrations uses the theremin. So let's listen to it, and you'll hear the wailing of the theremin in Good Vibrations, a very familiar piece of music. But this was news to Bob Moog, and very exciting, because here for the first time is a new genre of music, pop music, using electronic music in it.
I love the colorful clothes she wears, and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair.
You can relax.
Hear the sound of a gentle wind on the wind that lifts her perfume through the air. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations.
Okay, I apologize. Does it sound good? I can't tell. The speaker's a bit not so good. Is it okay? Good. Before we get to another piece of music, I'll go back to the PowerPoint a second. Then, oh, I hear it still playing in the background. I better switch it off. Otherwise, we'll hear music constantly. Okay. Oh, let me just play you this while I'm here. This, by the way, is a very typical Moog. This is the most popular bit of Moog music, this song, Popcorn. Listen to this. I'm certain you'll have heard this by Hot Butter. This is used in a million ads as well, a Nike ad. Here we go. That bass sound, that noise is the typical sound of the Moog synthesizer. I interviewed, by the way, the guy, Gershon Kingsley, who composed that piece of music. And he's a German-Jewish immigrant into New York City. And he's got all this other serious bits of music. He spent about 3 minutes composing the original theme for Popcorn, but that's the thing he's going to be remembered for, and made more money than any of his other pieces of music. Most typical story of these sorts of composers. Now I go back to the PowerPoint. Here we are. So we've got the new uses of the Moog appearing. Advertising, I mentioned, but one of the most important genres of music that's on the scene in this period, remember we're talking about the period 1964 to 1969, of course, is psychedelic music. Psychedelic music is all about washes of sound, little washes of sound, eerie sounds, using unconventional instruments. There's many instruments in psychedelia, the mellotron. Remember George Harrison playing the sitar. People are looking for unusual washes of sound with instruments, spacey sounds. Now, interestingly enough, the synthesizer designer who first discovered the link to psychedelia and the synthesizer was actually Don Buchla on the West Coast. And this is not at all surprising, because Don Buchla was designing his synthesizer. As I mentioned, he was at Berkeley. He was living in Haight-Ashbury in the middle of the whole countercultural revolution. He was friends with the Grateful Dead. He built synthesizers for the Grateful Dead and loudspeakers for the Grateful Dead. He consumed an enormous amount of LSD in designing his synthesizer. He openly confessed about this. It was pretty weird. I gave a talk at Berkeley a couple of years ago, and I had a slide contrasting Robert Moog with Don Buchla. And in it, on the slide, it had Don Buchla takes LSD and designs synthesizers. And he was in the audience, and he thought it was very cool. Didn't have a problem with it. So Buchla designs a synthesizer, which is used in a very famous episode in American popular culture by a guy called Ken Kesey. Ken Kesey is the guy who's running the Merry Pranksters. He's the author of One Flew Over the Cuckoo Nest. In this period of time, remember, LSD is legal in America at this point. His idea is to turn on America. So they go in this bus, this psychedelic bus called Fervor, on a trip across America, handing out LSD to people. And on the bus is a first Buchla synthesizer, the Buchla box, which is now in a museum in Calgary, which is the best synthesizer museum in America. Let me just make this image bigger. You can see this Buchla box. And so this box is producing psychedelic sound. They're realizing the synthesizer is really great, and it sounds really amazing if you've taken LSD. And I know you don't usually think of drugs and technology, but this project forces me to do that, because that's an important, if you look at any music genres today and technology, if you want to talk about house music, you've got to look at drugs like ecstasy and so on, which is an important way that the users experience the music, and this is true back then. I'm not recommending you do it, but that's just a historical fact. Buchla had his synthesizer at a very famous festival from the 1960s. There's an enormous amount of interest these days. A guy at Stanford University, Fred Turner, has written a nice book, From the Counterculture to Cyberculture, tracing the roots of the computer revolution in Silicon Valley with what was happening with the counterculture at the time. And one of the countercultural festivals of all, one of the most famous ones, is a festival called the Trips Festival in 1966, which was billed as an electronic simulation of an acid trip. And Steve Jobs was in attendance at this particular festival. Everyone was stoned out of their minds. And at the Trips Festival was a Buchla synthesizer shown here. And many of the lights and sounds were being put through the Buchla synthesizer. Big Brother and the Holding Company, Grateful Dead, many of these classic San Francisco bands were playing at this festival. So it's Buchla who first discovered the link between the synthesizer and psychedelic sounds. This is the album that was first West Coast album used a synthesizer. It's called Zodiac Cosmic Sounds. You can buy this album on eBay, an amazing record. It's in vinyl. On the back it says, must be played in the dark. And that synthesizer, I showed you the picture, the guy with the bald hair and the glasses, Mort Garson, played synthesizer on this album. Now what these psychedelic musicians were doing was they were looking for using little bits of Moog synthesizer on their records to make the sound more interesting, more psychedelically meaningful. There was an image at the time of the Moog synthesizer starts to become weird. It's a marginal thing. No waiter. This is a Punch cartoon. No waiter. Everything's not all right. For one thing, our daughter is running around with a man who plays a Moog synthesizer. It was considered a really weird, deviant thing on the edges of culture at the time to be involved with the Moog synthesizer and its links with psychedelia. One of the important pop festivals of the 1960s is the Monterey Pop Festival. You've probably seen the movie. Famous images of The Who smashing guitars, Jimi Hendrix smashing his guitar, burning it, and so on. Many famous bands there. And this is important in the history of the synthesizer, because I mentioned to you that Moog had a salesman in New York and one on the West Coast. And this West Coast salesman was actually at the Monterey Pop Festival, set up in a little tent outside where the main action was. And musicians, I've interviewed this salesman, musicians would come by, and there were, I guess, three preconditions for what was happening. One The Monterey is largely considered the place where the record industry discovers the San Francisco sound. And in those days, there were enormous advances. So these guys were suddenly very, very wealthy, these musicians. They could afford to buy these really expensive Moog synthesizers. The second thing was they were all on drugs. They were, you know, stoned on acid and whatnot. And the third thing was the Moog synthesizer was set up there. And these guys would wander through from Monterey, put on the speaker. It was set up on headphones. And this salesman would have these fantastic sounds set up on headphones. And these guys would hear this, and they'd say, hey man, got to have one of these on our next album. And the Beatles, the Doors, the Birds, these classic psychedelic bands from this era all bought Moog synthesizers. Sometimes I play a little bit of the Doors' Strange Days. It's used to modulate, the Moog synthesizer is used to modulate Jim Morrison's voice. But let's listen to a really famous track from this period, Here Comes the Sun. Which, if you, by the way, get the Beatles, it's on Abbey Road, have all been remastered. And the remastered version, the version I have here, MP3, is from the original one, is not as good as the remastered one. You can really hear the Moog synthesizer. George Harrison bought a Moog synthesizer. George Martin, sometimes called the fifth Beatle, the producer of the Beatles, also had a Moog synthesizer. And I'll tell you, let's listen to it, and we'll listen to the Moog synthesizer. I'll tell you which little bits to listen to. You'll hear it come in now, go to down.
It's
Moog synthesizer. There's about five different parts on this.
It's all right.
Got this up. We'll move out of that. Let's listen to Jim Morrison's voice on Strange Days, put through the Moog filter. I'm certain you've heard this before. I do not want to defrag my disc. By the way, all the Beatles could play the synthesizer. There's Paul McCartney playing the Moog synthesizer, Abbey Road. They all learnt to play it. It's used on four tracks. But then we go to the full-on psychedelic era. So this is a group called Tonto. This is the biggest synthesizer in the world, Tonto's expanding headband. And produced a classic album called Zero Time, all done on Moog synthesizer. Now, I've been hinting that one of the characteristic sounds of the Moog synthesizer, the only thing that Bob Moog had the patent on, is the filter. And it produces this bass sound that's just awesome. It's hard to describe. You have this whole problem of describing in words sound here. People sometimes say it's flatulent, the sound of the... But if you listen to Tonto, which is all done on Moog synthesizer, we're going to get to Switched On Bach in a second. I just want to play you a little bit of Cybernaut from Tonto's expanding headband, just so you can get the sound of the bass. So this is not just conventional instruments with little psychedelic things, just the whole thing is the Moog synthesizer.
Thank you.
was that bass sound people were after. Here's one, even Simon and Garfunkel. Actually, Paul Simon was pretty innovative in what he did, and you'll hear the bass sound at the start of this track by Simon and Garfunkel. Again, it's the Moog. Whoops, that's still Tonto. Go back again and hear it. Bob Moog himself set up the sounds for that session with Simon and Garfunkel, and he always tells this story about how a bass guitarist came through the session and turned pale because he could see the bass guitarist losing his job with this amazing bass sound that you could get out of the Moog synthesizer. Let's go back here. I think we're going to go to Switched On Bach. Now, if you look for your parents' record collection, if your parents still got any vinyl records, this is the one Moog album I bet they have. This is the double platinum Moog album, all made on the Moog synthesizer, Bach on a Moog synthesizer, that caused an absolute sensation and made the Moog synthesizer famous. We probably wouldn't have heard of the Moog synthesizer. You know, it was with psychedelic bands, little bits of washes of sound. But this is like a major release, record release with Columbia. It became a huge hit. Switched On Bach, performed by then Walter Carlos, who then became Wendy Carlos at the very time that this became a hit, one of the first major artists to have a sex change operation. It confused me at first. I found two W. Carlos's, and then I worked out what there was a Wendy and a Walter. It's the same person. A great title, Switched On, you know, catching the sort of 60s Switched On. You've got to be a Switched On person. In fact, it's, you know, Switched On also because it's Bach played on a synthesizer. So this was done with the aid of an early 8-track tape recorder. So you need a tape recorder. Each little snippet of sound is put together by Carlos. And Carlos, before doing Switched On Bach, was a recording engineer. So he had fantastic skills with the tape recorder at Gotham Studios in New York. And let's listen to a little bit. And there's always a problem in listening to these old pieces of music, because you have to try and imagine what it was like hearing this the first time. Something like Bach done on a Moog synthesizer, this strange instrument. Robert Moog himself tells this story about how he went to his professional organization, which was the AES, Audio Engineers Society, meeting in New York, and Carlos had given him a piece of the Brandenburg Concerto to play, and Bob says he put it on the tape, and these guys, he said they're sort of their poker face, hard-bitten engineer, they'd seen it all. He swears they got tears in their eyes when they hear that Bach could be done on the Moog synthesizer. So let's listen to a little bit from my iTunes here of Wendy Carlos' Switched On Bach. And it sounds a little bit corny, but it's still pretty amazing for its time. So doing Bach on the Moog synthesizer, that got a lot of attention. I played that piece, I don't know what you thought of it, I played that piece recently. I was giving a talk in Germany. There's a Bach scholar in the audience. He got really excited. He hadn't heard it before. I thought it was really amazing. So let's go back again. There's that incredible cover for Switched On Bach. Whoops, where are you there? So what happens? Switched On Bach is a huge hit. This is how the record industry works back that period. They figured, well, we've got to have a Moog synthesizer on whatever artist we have with their next record. And any genre of music is ready for Moogification. So this is the Switched On era. You can buy these albums on eBay. None of them have the artistry of Wendy Carlos, which is really phenomenal. And as I said, she had these great recording skills as well. But there's just so many of them. I just put up a few because they're kind of fun. That's Switched On Nashville, so it's country music done on the Moog. That's Switched on Bacharach, performed on the Moog synthesizer by Christopher Scott. That's More Switched on Bacharach by Sir Christopher Scott, obviously knighted for his contributions. There's about four Santa albums, Switched on Santa. And these are all, they're really kitsch, trust me. I'm not going to play them for you. Moog's factory, he was upstate New York. He employed mainly women who were quilters. They make quilts, and they had, basically their job is to stuffing circuit boards. This is the era of transistors. They're stuffing circuit boards with transistors and capacitors and resistors and so on. Very skilled at doing it. That's what his factory looked like, the only photograph we've got there. Place matters in terms of technological innovation. Buchler is part of the counterculture I mentioned. He lives in San Francisco, is friends with the Grateful Dead, consumes lots of LSD. Moog lives in this unhip place, Trumansburg. He's a bystander to the 1960s. He's a classic 50s engineer with a pen protector. He told me he attends pop parties but never inhales. He hired a sales rep in LA to deal with the people at Monterey Pop and so on, which Bob Moog refers to as the hippies. And he had very mixed feelings about the uptake of his synthesizer in psychedelia. Over a bottle of wine, it was down at Bob's house in Asheville for a weekend, and he said, you know, he'd never said this before, it's kind of interesting, that he really wanted the synthesizer to be taken up in the way that Wendy Carlos, he saw it as becoming a major classical instrument, rather than this use as it predominantly became in pop music. He was smart enough to realize that if pop people wanted to use it, he was going to get sales from it. But I think in his heart of hearts, he kind of hoped it was going to be used for making more classical type music, which it hasn't really been used for, I have to say. That, by the way, it's interesting to compare, and I'm going to play you this. I think it's important to hear the difference between the Buchler and the Moog here. This is the major hit at the same time as Switched on Bach was a gigantic hit on. This was a minor hit, a cult hit, Silver Apples of the Moon, by a composer called Mort Subotnick. And this is done on Buchler synthesizer. So you can just hear the sort of, it's just totally different, the sort of music that's played here. Let's listen to it. It's in a very different genre, the John Cage genre of electronic music. Very beautiful, but very different. See, it's not got the keyboard melodic at all. It's very sweeps of sound. You can hear the sequencer. At the moment, we can't hear anything. Let me just fast forward it a little. So the Buchler synthesizer has been used to make a very, very different sort of music, as you can tell. Okay. Buchler, by the way, deserves credit. He had on one of the things he invented was the first sequencer, which is a way, basically a programming a synthesizer. He had stored eight different voltages and it could be cycled through, and that's an amazingly important invention in terms later used in dance music, drum and bass music. That sequencer is at the heart of it, and Buchler was the guy who invented that, and Moog copied that from him. And Buchler deserves a lot of credit for that particular invention. Okay, that was Silver Apples of the Moon. I want to briefly talk about the Mini Moog synthesizer. I showed you the picture earlier. And this is kind of, the modular Moog synthesizer, expensive. It's hard to take for gigging musicians. It's not that stable. This becomes the classic synthesizer made by the Moog company in 1970-71. It's a hardwired synthesizer. So you haven't got those patch wires anymore. You've got switches. It's still an analog instrument. And you've got the built-in keyboard. You've got new controllers. This is one of the, you see these on virtually all synthesizers today. This pitch wheel for bending the pitch was an innovation they came up for the Mini Moog. An incredible instrument. And this is affordable for a whole new generation of musicians. In terms of prices back then, it's just over $1,000. It's about the price of a rock group's van. So it's still pretty expensive, but it's affordable. And this is important in terms of the history of synthesizers, because this is the first synthesizer that's put into retail music stores. So the story about why you can buy synthesizers in retail music stores, we've not only got the innovation of the synthesizer, there's also an innovation in sales and marketing going on here, of getting synthesizers into music stores, which is not a trivial thing, because this is a new instrument. And it's hard to play. You've got all these switches and knobs. And you introduce this in a music store, people are going to look at it and say, how the hell can you play sound? What's it going to do? You can make some sound on it, but what can you actually play some music on it? You've got to learn how to demonstrate this synthesizer. It's a very complicated instrument. Try and think of it in terms of, think of it like the violin. Imagine the violin as a new instrument before you've got a repertoire for it. It's really hard to play a violin instantly. It's not obvious it's going to be a success. It's the same for this mini Moog synthesizer. There's a very interesting story in terms of how it gets sold and put into retail music stores. And there's one guy who is at the center of this story, this guy here, whose name is David Van Couvering, who used to be an evangelist preacher before he became a Moog salesman. What he did, he had many ideas for introducing the Moog synthesizer. He had this little show which had novelty instruments, including the Moog synthesizer. He called it the science of sound. He became friendly with a guy called Glenn Bell, who was starting Taco Bell. This is the Glenn Bell who founded Taco Bell restaurants in America. Taco Bell restaurants were just spreading for America. Van Couvering would show up at a school to do his science of sound show and hand out free coupons for tacos. And later that evening, Van Couvering would be playing in the taco restaurant, playing the Moog synthesizer as the kids ate the tacos. And the idea was this would help spread the success of the Moog synthesizer. Again, no one was quite certain what genre of music was going to be used for. You can think of it like a Hammond organ or something. Van Couvering eventually forms off the coast of Florida, a man-made island there, off the coast of Florida by St. Petersburg, an event called the Island of Electronicus. That's Bob Moog there in the middle opening the event. And the first mini Moogs have just come off, and he realizes, off the production line, he realizes that young people can get enormous sonic energy when they play this mini Moog synthesizer. And this is the key to understanding the success of this mini Moog. In those days in bands, the guitarist was always the soloist, and the keyboardist would be doing fill-ins and be in the background. With the mini Moog, suddenly you have the sonic energy for a keyboardist to play the solos and become the front man of a band. You've also got a new genre of music coming. You've got this thing called progressive rock, which came out in the 1970s with bands like Emerson, Lake and Palmer, Yes, with a keyboard virtuosos like Keith Emerson and Rick Wakeman, and this is part of the success of getting these mini Moogs into music stores. What Van Couvering would do, after he opened this venue, the Island of Electronicus, he actually went around with mini Moogs in his Cadillac, went into music stores, and what he'd do was he'd find musicians in clubs who played keyboards. He'd lend them a Moog. They would eventually become good enough to make some interesting music with the mini Moog. He put big poster letters Moog on the back of the mini Moog. Then he'd take them. When the musician was convinced that he wanted the Moog, take them to the music store and convince the guy in the music store that here's your first customer, this guy here who wants this mini Moog. And he did that in lots and lots of music stores and slowly built a sales network for the mini Moog synthesizer. So it's basically a new way to demonstrate mini Moogs. And they're new users. These are young rockers who want to become doing this new progressive form of music. As Keith Emerson and Rick Wakeman both proudly told me, that beforehand it was the guitarist, I'm sorry, this is sexist language, the guitarist always got the girls in the band. But then when you became the keyboardist with a mini Moog, suddenly you were the soloists. So it's very important for them in terms of all sorts of things. There's Van Couvering with his map of America and basically setting up Moog retail stores all over America, then eventually all over the world. And that's how synthesizers get into the world. There's Keith Emerson of Emerson, Lake and Palmer. This genre of music called progressive rock. There's a hit I won't play you called Lucky Man, which is considered the definitive progressive rock solo on the Moog synthesizer. Anybody recognize this guy? Pete Townsend of The Who? He used a synthesizer called the ARP synthesizer. And who's next uses ARP synthesizer? Barbara O'Reilly, that's very distinctive little synthesizer track at the beginning, uses the ARP synthesizer. So this is a company in Boston that became Moog's main rival. We go through now quickly, 1970s, there's Brian Eno of Roxy Music using a British synthesizer, the VCS3, as used by the Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon. We get to Kraftwerk using Mini Moog, definitive German band. Trans-Europe Express is their most famous album. This has got a better picture, so that's why I put it up. Then you get movies using synthesizers to make the special effects in movies. Star Wars, this is Ben Burtt, the sound designer for Star Wars. Star Wars is the first movie to use the synthesizer, the ARP 2600, for all the special effects, including the R2-D2 voices in Star Wars. So here's another whole use of synthesizers. I have to show you this one because disco, anyone remember disco? This is Donna Summer and Giorgio Moroder, who I think is Italian. So in honor of being in Italy, let's listen. Someone sent me a little clip of I Feel Love. And this is produced by Giorgio Moroder. I think this is it. We have a bit of luck. Synth pop, 1980s, Devo with a Moog Liberation, shaped like a guitar. Human League, think of all those synth pop groups. In terms of the history of the synthesizer, 1983 is a crucial year. This is the first commercial digital synthesizer, the Yamaha DX7, which has an amazing range of sounds and can emulate most orchestral and acoustic instruments. Another little, I'm just doing this briefly just to give you a feel of the impact of this instrument. Most TV, if you go to a TV series like X-Files, about half the time you're hearing mood music. CSI is the same. The first, and this is all synthesized music for setting the mood, and the first show that famously does this is Miami Vice. And it uses Jan Hammer playing a Mini Moog back in 1984. And this is another huge use of synthesizers for making mood music in TV shows. And then going forward, I mean, there's a whole complicated story about house music and the reappearance of the synthesizer in, as Chemical Brothers, in dance music, which is another whole genre of music, a whole different stories about drugs and different style of music, but using synthesizer sequences, old Roland synthesizers, and so on. Okay. For a new instrument to be born. So what do we conclude from all this in terms of new instruments? We have this unique case here of a new instrument coming to being, one of the few instruments in the 20th century, the synthesizer. And these are some of the things that I think you need if you think about it in terms of the sociology and history of technology. You need new sorts of collaborations. Musicians have to get together with engineers to produce these new instruments. You have the importance, I think, of wider social movements like the psychedelic movement, which provides the initial impetus to the synthesizer. You have new musical genres like psychedelic rock, progressive rock, and so on. We have the standardization and ease of use of the synthesizer, why the Moog with the keyboard becomes the dominant one, why the book club, it has a niche market still, Buckler's still alive, still producing these synthesizers. Madonna bought one a couple of years ago. He's still selling them. They're very high end. But it's a niche market. You need familiar interfaces. Moog developed new ways to recruit and learn from users. And I also would add here, it's not on the slide, a new innovative way of selling synthesizers as well, getting with Vancouver synthesizers into retail music stores. And the outcome of all this is a transformation in our soundscape. As I said before, 1964, we had hardly been exposed to electronic sound at all. Now we're saturated with electronic sound. And working out how to think about what that electronic sound means, how we capture it, how we describe it as historians, sociologists, is another whole project. So issues to think about, I'm sort of concluding now, in terms of users. It's always important to think of who are the users. Moog, as I said, had found new users, recruited users. Users, are they the same as consumers? And here it's important to think, not always. If we're talking about consumption technology, maybe they are. But lots of technologies are used, say, a technology could be used in production, in a factory, a new lathe could be used. So the users are there, is in another, in a production context, not consumers. So it's wrong to think that users are always the same as consumers. It's important to think about who are the non-users of a technology. Why are they not using it? And what does it mean to be a non-user? Another thing we can think about here are intermediaries. There's a lot of interest these days in intermediaries. These are people who are between the users and the producers. And these are people like salespeople who move backwards and forwards, and repair people. Repair people turn out to be a very, very important group, because repair people often see how the technology is actually used in its everyday use by the user. When it fails to work, it's broken down. And they can discover things about how the users are using the technology. Famously, when that Yamaha DX7 synthesizer came along, repair people found this synthesizer, you could store sounds in sound cards, was the technology that then, an early form of the memory. And they found that all that was recorded in the sound cards were the standard factory sounds. The synthesizer was too hard to program. They learned that from the repair people. So they had to think about, could they make it easier to program the synthesizer. In fact, what happened was a separate cottage industry developed for programming the Yamaha DX7 synthesizer. So intermediaries are important groups to study. New spaces and forums where users can have input. Moog, as I said, brought users to his factory, which was a novel idea, to think about how you can learn from these users. Are the users scripted or configured by the designers? Thinking in terms of how the technology, this idea of the script again, this powerful idea of Madalena Krish's, how it is that a particular way of interacting with a technology is embedded into the technology, has all sorts of ramifications, I think. And then how users resist technologies, the anti-program with the seatbelt example, how users can resist these technologies. How important is that for us to study and learn from perhaps new directions for technology, from how users are resisting technologies? I'll quickly end. I want to get us to have discussion. We finish at 12:30, do we? Yeah, so I've got time to do this. Let me just mention a little bit about the Web 2.0 and the role of users there. I mean, the important thing here, people will usually say, is that production in the Web 2.0 era, production and consumption are blurred. This is because the content, you know, if you think of Facebook, you think of MySpace, this website I'm studying, Acid Planet, think of the book reviews and product reviews on Amazon.com are produced by the user. So most of the content is being produced by the user. So you have this blurring. It's harder to say you have producers over here and consumers over there. There's a blurring between the two. Okay, the open source movement is part of this, user-generated content. And one could think here of the implications of this, and this is just a quick point about comparing three different websites, Wikipedia, acidplanet.com, and amazon.com. Now, all these three websites have the feel of Web 2.0. They all espouse a kind of user-based Web 2.0 ideology. But the implications, I think, are rather different for each of these three websites. So Wikipedia, in general, uses user-provided content for the good of all, for a social good. So we all benefit from going on Wikipedia. And it's hard to say that anyone's making a particular profit from Wikipedia at the moment. Acid Planet, on the other hand, is a website that Sony purchased themselves. So it's owned by, in the commercial sector, by Sony. And it provides a place for amateur musicians to share music. And people on that website really love that platform for doing that. They can review each other's music. One of the great things about this website, Acid Planet, acidplanet.com, is you immediately get a chart position for your music. And there are all sorts of genres of charts. So you imagine you just produced a piece of music. Sony often, by the way, it's electronic music. Loop-based is the main genre. But you can do other sorts of music there. And you can become number one on Acid Planet. And but I've got so many emails from musicians up here who send me an email when they're number one on Acid Planet. So this whole thing about the charts is kind of addictive. But Sony is still trying to, is using this website to get its products out. It's trying to sell its Acid software, which is a way of turning your computer into a digital recording studio, essentially. It's a bit like GarageBand for Mac. So Sony's selling products at this website, okay. Amazon is another interesting example because it's using the content. When we all write reviews for Amazon, if you've ever done this, anybody can write a product review on Amazon. And if you write enough of them, you can get a ranking on Amazon. They have a we're doing a study at the moment of the top 1,000 reviewers on Amazon. You can get a badge if you become a top 1,000 reviewer. And this is based on how useful your reviews are found by other visitors to the website and also by how many you do. But this content, which is provided, when you do a product review, you provide that content for free. Basically, you do a book review or a movie review, or nowadays, any product on Amazon, you can write a review for it. You provide that content for free, and Amazon basically is using that content to sell more of those goods. In the early days, when Amazon started as a website, it saw itself as a literary magazine and hired editors to write reviews. But when they discovered reader reviews, they could get rid of the literary editors and just use reader reviews. So the implications seem to be different in all these three cases because basically Amazon, it's a very interesting moment. They're using the readers and this sort of Web 2.0 ideology, but at the same time, the users are not being paid for it. Amazon's making tons of money on it, but people who write the reviews aren't getting paid. And in fact, in our study, we asked them if they'd like to get paid. They said, no, good God, it would undermine the whole basis of it. So people have other projects where they want to do this for free, but it's noticeable that Amazon is benefiting hugely from it. So here's a conclusion. We need a conclusion. The thorough understanding of the role of users in technological development requires a methodology that takes into account the multiplicity and diversity of users. I couldn't stress that enough, that these studies of users point to many sorts of different users, and often it's the user you haven't thought of that turns out to be important. So, say, in the story, The Development of the Mouse by Douglas Engelbart, it was originally had a very complicated mouse because he was thinking of other computer scientists as being the user. But when you get the idea that the user for the computer is going to be just everyone, like here in this room, then you've got to make a much more simple device, and that's a really important message. Who speaks for the users? Where are the places where the technology, we call it co-constructed, where's the technology made with users playing a role? From this perspective, technological development emerges as a culturally contested zone where users, we can move on to look at medical technologies, patient advocacy groups, consumer organizations, designers, producers, salespeople, policymakers, and intermediary groups create, negotiate, and give different, sometimes conflicting forms and meanings and uses to technology. So if you want a formal conclusion, that's actually from this review article I did with Nelly Auchin, but that's sort of the wider take-home message of these studies of users.